Welcome to Group Modeling Part 2, the demise of the effort. Or what? I knew that last week was probably not well set, but I wanted to see what happened. And I actually think that some meaningful things came out of it. Though today what I'd like to do is not work on the model, but spend some time talking about the process and see what we can do about ironing out something that would make the undertaking more productive, less chaotic, would sort of encourage people to engage rather than run away. So for those of you who were here last week, hello, Michael, welcome. Would like your thoughts on what you experienced last week and what you thought we might do to improve the engagement. So we can start with you, John.
I wasn't on last week.
Oh, okay. Well, then it's probably not good to ask you. Maybe you were lucky that you weren't here last week.
Gene, if I may.
I'm a new entrant into the dynamics of the model.
Oh, okay. All right.
Gene, if I may.
Yes?
One of the principles of having an effective meeting is to have kind of an agenda where there's facilitation, and I like, sometimes they call it a parking lot, so that if the meeting, let's say some of the topics may not appear to be immediately integrated into what we want to see in the model, we could put that on the parking lot and just say, okay, so let's hold off on that for a while. Let's try to focus on the primary things that we think are appropriate for this particular model.
Okay. And
I think from that perspective, it might help move things along.
Okay. I'm going to try and take notes in addition to what gets captured on the video. And after we go through the sequence, I'll sort of try and offer my thoughts. Were you here last week, Franco?
Yes.
And
unfortunately, I was very busy working in London. I will watch the video that recorded, but you know, I have some thoughts that we could share about you know, making things effective, because it's part of my daily challenge. You know, I'm a consultant, so I have to be good at things, at these things, and I'm learning day after day new tricks. So if I may, if I may express my thoughts, you know, I think that which may be considered obvious, but I will take the risk of expressing them. It's about, you know, for every attendee has to see something in the presentation or in what is being said that touches his heart and his brain. So it's got to be recognized as part of his or her life. I discovered, you have put it very, very clearly and well, Gene. You know, this story that is one of the very important lessons I've learned from you has to be seen as part of the life of the individual that is attending the meeting, right? So you should recognize some of the experiences that you've had in your life in what you're listening to. Because otherwise the story become, no matter how well it is being told, the story will become something alien to your heart and to your feelings. So, for example, in my career, I have come across the kind of stuff that you have explained very well, Gene, many, many, many times. You know, I'm a consultant, and therefore I'm always dealing with gaps between a situation that people would like to be in versus the situation they are in. So it resonates a lot with me when I watch your videos, right? The trick, of course, is telling the right story in the right way, using the language that people understand. For example, one of the things I've learned the hard way is that, and this I'm afraid is very, very, very close to the English culture, or maybe also the American one. In the UK, for example, I have learned that people say that they have understood or they nod. Reality, they haven't understood. So if I ask them to repeat, for example, what I said, just for the sake of making it clearer, I discover that they have not understood. So there is also a cultural element to this communication challenge. For example, we Italians, excuse me, are much more direct, right? If we don't understand, we say, what the hell are you talking about? Excuse me. Which probably is closer to the American culture in a way. Probably what I said applies more to English, to the English culture. They are kind of reluctant to say that they have not understood. And in some, there are other cultures that I've come across that are similar. I don't know if any of you has worked with people from the Far East. They tend to hide the fact that they've not understood because it's seen as a weakness. This is a very cultural problem, right? So back to the question, I don't know if you will find a formula that works with everybody, but you know, there are cultural type obstacles that have to be overcome. This is my personal experience. I don't know if what
people,
I said.
People being unwilling to admit that they don't understand is a problem experienced here in the States also.
Yeah, and this is what leads people to either lose level of attention or abandon a conversation or a meeting or a workshop or whatever, right? So keeping the level of attention high is a huge challenge, which is affected by many factors. One of them, as I said, being cultural. One of them is dealing with topics that somehow the attendees have experienced before. So it's not easy. I understand very, very well your concern, and yeah. So these are my
okay
suggestions. Right. So I will mute myself now.
Bechara.
I don't agree with you that it was a complete mess last time.
Oh, well.
No.
Maybe you're more tolerant than others.
And not a question of tolerance. I think that we are trying to learn something new. So it's I was expecting something not to go around, okay, and it will take time. That's why we have more than one session for the same topic. No, I enjoy it. I enjoy it really. Even if we didn't achieve something consistent, but it was for me positive.
Welcome, y'all.
Hello, everyone.
Were you here last Thursday?
Yes, I was. Sorry about
So what we've been doing to this point is asking people to provide thoughts about the experience from last Thursday. The idea today is to try and talk about the process and how we might put a bit more order in the process so that it could actually be more productive and a bit less chaotic for the participants.
Okay, I made some comments last week, but just let me go put a shirt on. So.
Okay. So some thoughts that I had was I should announce the topic in advance so that people have an opportunity, if they're interested, to sign up to participate in the session and possibly do some research before the session actually happens. Secondly, I can't do everything at once. In terms of trying to facilitate, see, I can't talk and type at the same time. Facilitate, build the model, and read the chat. It's just, I can't focus in several places at once. So I think it takes more than one person. In other words, I think somebody needs to, in other words, I went back and read the chat from last Thursday, and there were some really good comments in the chat that never ended up in the model itself because it just fell off the edge. So that where people should be able to put things in the chat that they want to be captured, which might be more lengthy than what actually gets captured in the model, and be supplied for reference. And but somebody should be reading the chat on an ongoing basis and interrupting if there's something they think is critical in there that ought to get interjected into the model. Now, there's a way in this environment for people to raise their hand to say, I have something I want to add, as opposed to everybody trying to figure out where they ought to interject, so that if a person raises their hand, I could then actually go ahead and call on them to say, okay, Franco, you have a comment, and then it would be your turn. And then once you've actually added your piece, oh, Yul has raised his hand, so I guess he has something to say?
No, I just want to make sure it works.
Oh, okay. Well, that works also. And then once you've talked, you can go ahead and put your hand down. It seems, in this particular context, it seems useful. And would that, in fact, bother anybody to do that in that way?
James.
Oh, Michael says no.
That would work. That would work.
Say again?
I think that what you said would work.
Oh, okay. Okay. Let's see. Use. To indicate. I can't spell IN. Something to add. Also, in terms of, rather than doing general exposés about the concept or the content or whatever it is the topic is, I would think that a person should have, you say, I have a piece that I would like to add and I don't know where it goes, so we simply add an item and so it doesn't get lost. Or they say, I'd like to connect something to something because I think this influences this or this is influenced by that, so that they've sort of watched the unfolding of the model and said, here's where I think there's something that should be added. Does that make sense?
Yes, it makes, in my opinion, it makes sense because it would, what's the word, complete the thought process. You know, if I understood you correctly, you're suggesting that whoever is attending indicates that there is something that maybe he thinks was missing, you know, there was a step missing. Instead of going from A to B, there should be an A1, A to A1, and then to B. Is that what you meant?
Right.
So inserting an element between one element and another one that you're suggesting to connect. Is that what you were suggesting?
Can I jump in, Gene?
Yeah. You have your hand up.
I didn't try to take it down yet. I mentioned this in my comments, my written comments last week, but my experience with this kind of initiative has been to work with larger teams and to break them down to sub-teams, number one. Number two, yes, everybody got 3 or 4 pages of documentation. Even if they were subject experts, you want to focus them on specifically what it is that particular session wants to focus on. But then the other thing that I did, and again, I have no idea, I'm not an expert in systems mapping, but I use concept board. And what we did was everybody brought to the table the elements, and we put all the elements up. Then we decided whether those elements were all on the same level or some of them were internal parts of other elements. I'm a systems analyst, so you'll have to pretend you understand me. And only after we decided that we agreed on which elements we should be working with, then we started discussing, okay, so how do they interact? So, you know, I noticed that that's not what you did. You immediately go from, okay, this element, and immediately start looking at its connectivity and if it's an impeder or a enabler or a
inhibitor.
But having done it in this in my rather slow step-by-step fashion, it made the chaos of having 25 people trying to work on the same map much easier. Only 5 people actually accessed the map, and everybody, you know, would speak to one of those people would be responsible for a different area of the map. Anyways, that's just to share my experience of virtual map making.
So one of my thoughts also was that a smaller group, 4 to 6 people, would seem appropriate. If you had 25 people, 5 groups of 5 probably works better. And if you had 25 people in this environment, you could break those 25 people out into 5 subgroups, let each one of the groups work on their own map, and they could come back and then present their map to the rest, to the other groups.
That's basically what we did.
Okay. And I have done that in workshops. And it was interesting and somewhat enlightening to all the other groups about how the perspectives of the different groups were different. The mistake that was then made was someone took all the maps away and tried to integrate them together, and they produced something that nobody understood. And trying to get the 5 groups to integrate the 5 maps together seemed to be torturously painful. So having experienced both of those approaches not working well was the reason that I thought about figuring out what the question was or what the thing was that you wanted to understand and build from that particular entity outward, as opposed to being all over the place and try to figure out how all those pieces connected together. If someone has a piece that they don't know where it goes, you can put it on the map. I mean, here's one that someone said that we should put on here about China rare metals. We didn't know what to do with it at the point, but they wanted to make sure that we didn't lose it. Would you like to comment on that set of thoughts, y'all?
Well, again, we used a concept board, and then the integration part we didn't do. We had like 8 or 10 sessions once a week, one session for 2 or 3 hours. And what would happen was at each of the subsequent sessions after each group had done their part, we started looking at, okay, where does map number one interact with any of the other maps? And then focused on that session only on the relationship between elements in the second map with the elements in the first map, with everybody discussing it, which got chaotic. Okay. we did most of our work asynchronously and without video chats, but it was still so the end product was an incremental end product, where over a period of 8 weeks you would be adding layers of complexity, not all at once, but looking at each individual team and seeing how that worked together. So think of it in terms of the various departments in a municipal city environment. And of course, one's dealing with security, another one's dealing with infrastructure, another one's dealing with education and transportation, so on and so forth. Everybody had their map. And then afterwards, we started looking at, okay, how do they interreact?
Okay. So if you're talking about that kind of a context where different groups actually have different functions or purposes, then they're mapping their view of reality, and then it's appropriate to see where the different realities connect to each other.
Yeah, but even in tariffs, if we want to focus on what you're doing, there are different aspects of it. There's the concept of the consumer side of the thing. There's the concept of international monetary trade aspect of things. There's government policy in China, government policy in America. Each one of these things can actually be analyzed and studied independently, even though that eventually they're all going to have to interreact.
Right. It's all connected. And you know, if you study them independently, you have a view of a piece of the puzzle. Right? And though if you want to understand tariffs, you need to have a sense of all of the pieces of the puzzle that are related to the piece that you want to understand. Yes, no? I mean, I'm offering perspectives, not answers. So you can agree or disagree.
I agree.
I abstain.
Okay.
If I may add something that what has just been said has triggered, in my opinion, a very important concept, which is the level of detail of the elements that form part of a map. This is an example of something very close to my heart and to my brain, because I'm a planner, right? I'm an engineer, but I've been working in planning and project controls for decades, right? So the concept of relationships is very, very familiar to me. And one of the challenges I have to face is the level of detail of the relationships that I establish. For example, I was literally on a call 2 hours ago with the director of the project I'm working on. And we were talking about relationships amongst work packages, right? Which are groups of tasks, sorry, that have been broken down in groups of tasks. I was talking about this topic with the project director because this is an example of a high level set of relationships, right? An example of a low level set of relationships is the set of relationships that I will have to establish amongst the activities that form part of each work package, right? Maybe if I give you an example, it will be clearer. So one of the work packages that I've broken this project into is called design, is the set of activities which will produce the design of a project, whatever the project could be. And then there is another work package which is about procuring the material and equipment that this work package is about. Right. Obviously, if you don't have the design of something, you don't know what you need to buy. So at a high level, you may say the design macro process, which could be an element in the chart, is linked or is related to the other big guy, which is the procurement of the, and so on, right? So talking about high level relationships rather than low level relationships is, for example, is very important because the number of entities you are dealing with may be substantially bigger, right? The telephone call I had 2 hours ago was about relating some 15 items. So a relatively simple map, whereas the detailed one, the lower level one, will probably include, I don't know, 300 elements on the same chart, which becomes very, you know, much more complicated to understand. So this concept of level of detail of the items that appear on a map is, in my opinion, very important. It may determine, you know, a high level of attention, or it may make people leave the session because it's too difficult. You know, it's an important aspect, in my opinion.
So if I am attempting to understand the transportation system, I don't need to take the car engine apart. Okay?
Yes.
Because it's two completely different levels of detail.
Yes.
In terms of relationships.
Right. And if I introduce the magic word system, right, which is again always present in my life, system as in system engineering, you know, a system may be huge and the component may be very, very small. So this concept of level of detail in my personal experience has been very, very important, and I'm still working on it, so to speak.
Yes, I completely. Would anyone like to comment on Franco's comment?
Yes. But one of the things that bothers me about systems maps, see, I'm a systems analyst, right? And so we have granulation. In other words, we also have encapsulation. So when Frank was talking about a procurement process, inside that procurement process, there can be sub-processes, but they're all encapsulated within the meta process called procurement. From the procurement process, there will be extensions and relationships to other meta processes.
Yes.
But they're going to be inside the procurement processes, little subroutines that relate to each other, but they don't have any outward connection.
Yes.
And I don't have the ability to create that kind of a granulation or encapsulation with Kumu, for instance. Anyways. That's what I was just thinking what he was.
Okay. So specifically to your comment, Yul, you actually do in terms of let me go. Is it okay if I deviate here for a moment, people?
Yeah, fine with me.
Okay. This is a Hawaii quality of life model that was done, early on in the life of Kumu. And this is an overall system map.
How do I get to that screen?
I'll give you a link to it in the chat room, in the chat window. Okay? It's a public project. While this shows a whole set of relationships, if you open it up, zoom in on it, you can see that it says economic performance is dependent upon intergroup agility economic loop. And it says R7. This is actually a whole nother level of detail on another map. Where's R7? R7. It's this particular loop in detail. So that bubble on that other map expands into this level of detail. What isn't evident about Kumu is that you can have lots of different maps in the same project. So while the overall systems map is meant to provide a level of abstraction for a lot of the detail, every piece that is on this map actually has another loop or loops that are the detailed portion of that map. Does that help you all?
Yes. I'm sure that you're all familiar with Visio Professional. And if you can draw a process chart in which each box is actually a sub-process, right? I'm sure that you've seen it before. Right. So it's the equivalent of you click on a box and the sub-process associated to that box is displayed.
So you can do levels of abstraction the environment so that you don't have to hit in this particular context, where this is the overall systems map. If you included all of this detail, there'd be 200 elements on this map. I mean, it's already overwhelming the way that it is. And if you tried to include all of the detail at once, it would be even more overwhelming.
And that's where you're very, very important and wise suggestion to unfold these models comes into the picture, because if you don't open them up, if you don't unfold them, you will make people fall asleep.
Just drive them away. There's another feature in Kumu that I found out about yesterday that they developed, and I didn't even know they did it, and it's called partial views. So this is a map that somebody did, and what they enabled is to go ahead and allow you to look at segments of this map piece by piece, as opposed to and you can very quickly focus in on some part of this. So, and the nice thing that I like about this particular feature is that you don't lose the context, so that I'm looking at a portion of it, but I still have a sense of where it is amidst the larger context. I just started playing with it yesterday and I need to figure out what I can do with it. I think it will allow me to not have to actually create presentations, because I think I can do this and do videos directly from partial views. So I digress, way off of topic. Other thoughts? Other thoughts about the actual development process that might make it more orderly?
Maybe we could say something about the meaning of the relationship, you know, you can add notes to the relationships, right? But when an element is connected to another, you know, some logical thought is triggered, right? Maybe it would help to expand on this. I'm just thinking loud now. At least this is what it's very easy to draw these lines, but that's where I think one may make other people fall asleep.
And I agree with that, in that typically when I develop relationship models, this is the empty one. Template.
Can I take advantage of the hiatus here?
Sure, go ahead.
See, one of the tariff exercise. Every exercise that I've been trying to use mapping for has had different kinds of elements and different kinds of connections. Just to give you a quick example, we're dealing with the environment that either impedes or facilitates the integration of special needs people into individuals into the general community. So we have different kinds of organizations. We have funding organizations. We have normal social welfare organizations that deal with the general population as well as special needs. And then you have donor and, you know, you have funding relationships. So one of the first things we had to do before we could even put the elements on the board was to put all the elements on the board and then try to categorize them, what kind of elements, so that when we put them on a map, we could identify them as being the different kinds of entities and the different kinds of relationships that they have.
Okay.
Something the tariff model totally ignores, and all the elements are the same. There's no difference for policy or for economic factors or for... Okay. Anyways, I just thought I'd throw that out, that that's an element of almost every map that I have to deal with has this step of trying to categorize the different kinds of elements and the different kinds of connections.
And in the causative diagrams that I typically develop, I have two kinds of entities. I have stocks and I have variables. And in terms of the relationships, I typically go ahead and affix descriptions mm-hmm. to them so that I describe what the relationship specifically is, so that if someone comes here in the future and they mouse over it, it will pop up and it will show them what that relationship actually means from a textual description, as opposed to assuming that they just understand what the connection means. And I do the same thing for all of the variables and what could happen in this particular development context is if there were several people who understood how to use the environment, once we made the connection, somebody else could go ahead and put the text in the background while we were continuing to evolve the model.
Mm. Now, this is very good. If I may ask a general question about the text on the arrows, right? Should the text not always be or contain a verb? Because the general rule is that an element on the map has an influence on another, or is being influenced by another, correct?
Correct.
So if we were to follow the principle that each connection could be labeled in order to make the connection clearer, my question is, Should the text not always contain a verb which explains what A does to B? Question. This is a question.
Any thoughts on that question?
I took it for granted.
Yes. Okay. But the example you had on the screen, Jean, the screen before this one, had a text, if I'm not mistaken, same, right? Same, may be misunderstood, maybe?
Yes, might be, which is why I then went ahead, okay, and added a description for it. Same, yes. Means that from the legend, in that if principal increases, the interest increases, and if the principal decreases, the interest decreases.
Yes.
Shorthand.
When you hover over it, you make it foolproof. But my suggestion was to put a short label that contains a verb. That was my suggestion.
Okay.
It's a kind of generic rule, right? That, I don't know if it works all the time. But.
Well, and if you're walking through a relationship model in one direction, you know, you could say principal increases interest.
Okay.
That's the verb you're looking for.
Okay.
Okay. But if principal decreases, then it decreases interest. So how do you write that in a verb? Say increases or decreases, which I think would be confusing.
Yeah, okay. No, you're right. You're right.
Okay.
As I said, I was thinking loud. Maybe I was thinking loud.
I agree with you about the connection implies an action. Mm-hmm. We try to use positive noun or noun phrases as elements. So we don't get into this something increases, decreasing, whatever, okay? Mm-hmm. Say that we have decreasing environmental cost. And then what influences decreasing environmental cost? It just drives us nuts. So in terms of your comment about labeling them with some sort of action is appropriate. The typical difference that I have always tried to make is between variables and stocks, because that's why it says adds to or same, because if interest increases, it adds to the principal. If interest decreases, it still adds to principal, just not so much. And it's the nature, or it's the difference between things which are stocks, which accumulate or decline over time, and things which are instantaneous variables that are computed or constants.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I understand.
Don. You're doing a lot of typing. Want to make some comments? Don's being quiet. We have to unmute you, Don.
That comment about cause and effect being displayed on screen, that's a very good one. And the opportunity to... like in this tariff example, there's a lot of cause and effect that's being assumed in that whole argument, that if the assumptions were brought to the forefront, we could get past the controversy of it really quickly, in a real-time sort of a way.
Okay, such as?
Well, for example, on the short term, as an American, I might agree with tariffs, but for the long term, the real protection is in being competitive, innovative, productive. And I'm not a participant in the American auto industry, but we're not necessarily competitive. Okay?
Okay.
Now, someone who grew up an American farmer, I will tell you that across the vast upper Midwest, it has been so wet that there is a large amount of crop that is not in the ground. So in a few months, we might want some friends. Just say.
I agree.
When the cause and effect of the tariff situation is remembered and felt. So I'll throw that out there and go back mute.
Okay. Thank you. Well, John, come back from being mute again, and you said the assumptions?
Well, there is a lot of complexity in what's on the screen right now.
Okay.
And I think Tuesday, when you were talking about archetypes, you said... you were talking about the abortion situation.
Okay.
You've observed that in any complex situation, when you boil it down, there are two or maybe three variables that actually drive the whole situation. And what are the two or three that drive tariffs?
Okay.
Now, as a tool, this should drive people through some of the posturing and some of the power politics and all that stuff to, okay, hey, long term, what can we agree on here?
Okay. I will go back through what's in the chat window after the session and pull out those things that seem to fit in certain places. And as I said before, there was a whole bunch of stuff in the chat window during last Thursday's session that I never got to until Thursday afternoon when I actually had a chance to sit down and read through it. And I'm glad that it was there, and it didn't actually get lost. It was all captured. The whole chat session is here as part of that session. Anything else? Would any of you like to participate in another one in the future?
Yes, I would.
Yeah, I'm game. I mean,
would you like to suggest some possible topics?
Yes, I will.
Okay.
In the meantime, let me. I expected to talk about archetypes as
today. I'm sorry.
The criteria that I have for an exercise, as opposed to something for real, is something that people can find adequate information online, that it is. What's the English word? Conscribed, restricted to a narrow enough topic that it can be adequately documented in a 2 to 4 hour period. I do a lot of that with Kuma acumen courses in system mapping. So. You know, that's, I can give you, you want the topics right now off the top of my head, or you want to?
Well, you can give me some of them so we can consider them, type them into the chat window. One of the previous comments was that the topic to be considered should be announced ahead of time, and people should have an opportunity to do some research on it if they choose to before the session. And if people wanted to develop their own relationship model before the session, they could bring it to the session and present it to the attendees.
My suggestion would be that, yes, everyone should have a number of days to know what the topic is, perhaps have two or three links to online resources if they want to read a couple of articles about it so they can be a little bit more well-informed, rather than having to read articles about American and Chinese tariff war while we're having the discussion. But the other thing I would say, though, in my personal experience, is that if anybody does create any models before they come to the session, they keep them under their hat.
And they shouldn't present them to each other.
No, because it's a fait accompli. It's like, I guess you never served in the military.
I did.
You did. So you know that whenever you're having a discussion around the table, you always ask the person who's got the highest rank last. In other words, when you're having a discussion around a corporate table, you always ask the person who's most prepared last. Otherwise, they hear the ideas of someone who's already put it all together and they say, yeah, of course.
Right.
And it becomes groupthink rather than a creative collaborative adventure.
It's very easy to just agree, right? No thought required.
Yeah, the nodding syndrome. Just nodding is very, very simple. One point that I would like to make is, you know, there are obviously so many potential topics that could be discussed that it's not going to be easy to find some topics that are common to many people.
Well, there are lots of potential attendees. So for whatever this topic is, I'm sure I could find a half a dozen people interested in participating.
Yeah, I was going back to what was said earlier, right? Say forming groups of five or six individuals. And what would make the session more efficient and effective is to find the topic that interests them all, right? They should all know a little bit about this topic. This is one approach. Another approach that I've experienced in some workshops that I have organized is to bring together on purpose people that do not have knowledge on the topic to see if they have anything new to add, new points of view. For example, we invited, as I told you, I'm an engineer, right? We invited people that do not know anything about engineering to meetings that were intended to trigger some thoughts from coming from completely different viewpoints. And it was useful. So there are two schools of thoughts. One is to bring specialists together or subject matter experts together. And the other one is to bring people completely different together for the purpose of discovering if anything new is being introduced or suggested.
I tell people that once upon a time I used to develop models and share them with other people because I wanted to impress them with how smart I was, and they really didn't care. And what I finally realized is that the only reason to share a model with other people is in the hopes that they will ask questions that you didn't think to ask, so you can figure out how to improve the model. So,
in fact, the I don't know where I saw it, but I mean, I've got a whole library of systems mapping and whatnot. My experience echoes what I read, and that is that the more diverse the group, the more the collaboration is effective. I'll tell you why. Because groupthink, the moment that you have people who don't have an insider's perspective on the subject, they start asking questions that cause the subject experts to have to explain themselves. If you have a whole bunch of systems analysts, you can be assured 100% that whatever map they're going to make will totally be ineffective because they are a closed circle. But you have to have people from various. That's number one. My criteria, therefore, for a subject has always been a subject which, again, Franco, this is an exercise. The objective here is the mapping, learning how to do it, not the map itself. We're not here to try to create a map to solve the world's problems. After we've learned how to use maps, then we'll all go out and solve the world's problems. So the problem we're trying to identify to use for an exercise has to be one that people can, that's small enough to be worked on in a short period of time, whatever that is, 2 hours, 2 or 3 sessions, 2 hours each, and that everybody has equal access to the minimum information necessary to learn what they need to know in order to talk intelligently in the meetings. Okay? So it could be, how can we, what are adequate solutions for homeless in urban environments? And if you say that's too broad, okay, no problem. So let's look at Vienna. Let's look at London. Let's look at some place where we can go on the internet and say London and homeless. And look and do some, and everybody can pull out equally the same amount of information. And then we can try to map that and figure out what the issues are. That's the kind of thing I'm talking about. So the idea is not so much the subject's not that important, as much as it is that it's a subject which is small enough and that everybody has equal access to an adequate amount of information to make the exercise useful.
So let me make sure that I understood you correctly. You're suggesting that it's more important to focus on the methodology, on the approach, on the way to approach this topic rather than the topic itself. Is that what you said?
I'm saying that in this forum, that's why I came here.
Okay, fine.
I didn't come here to solve America and China's tariff problem.
I agree.
Learn more about how can we build system maps in a very unique virtual environment.
Yes, I agree. So we are, I understand and I agree. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yola, it sounds like you and I are here for absolutely the same reason. it is because, you know, it's very easy for me to sit down and build a relationship map based upon what I think I understand. And then I can go do some research and evolve it some. Though from your comments, it always gets better with a set of very diverse perspectives brought to the table to ask questions and not a half a dozen people that all begin with the same perspective because they don't need to talk to each other. They all have the same level of understanding to start with. And if you sent them away, they develop maps that look pretty much the same.
Now, the only thing I'd like to jump in and say, Gene, is that whatever tool this is, I don't remember, Zoom something?
Kumu. Kumu.
No, the tool, this video chat.
Oh, Zoom.
Zoom. So the tools that I use for video chat, we can open up the chat window on the right side, on a column on the right side. So in addition to whatever interactions are going on the screen, the chat window is open to everybody. They can see, and it becomes a sort of like a back channel without having to whisper.
Don't you have the chat window open?
Yeah, no, the chat window is not a column that I can put inside. It covers up part of the, I cover Bihara or Michael, one of the two, but I can't see all of them at the same time.
Oh, I see. Well, you could make the displayed, the part of the window that I'm sharing, you could make that smaller.
Right, I saw that. I did that now. Okay, fine. Okay. Now I have what I want. Thank you very much.
Okay. Sorry. All new technologies take getting used to. I mean, it took me a half a dozen sessions just to figure out how not to get all of the thumbnails for the participants to show up in the video, because it made the shared portion of the screen smaller and harder to see in the video.
So why don't we do the following? Why don't we say that everybody who has an idea that they want to share will send it off to you within the next 12 hours, and then you can either decide arbitrarily which one or solicit our feedback. I use polls, but listen, it's your rodeo.
I'm not an arbitrary kind of guy.
Oh, come on. Executive command.
Which is an arbitrary statement in and of itself, isn't it?
I'm not going to say anything. Tell you what.
Okay, so what I'll do is I'll take all of my notes and I'll put them into a Google Docs document, and I'll send you all links so you can edit it, and we'll see what kind of chaos that creates, and we'll see where we go from there. How's that? That makes sense? Fine.
Yes, it makes sense. I would like to add something super obvious, but I will say it anyhow. In terms of effectiveness of the communication nowadays, as we all know super well, pictures are very highly appreciated. So any chart that contains also pictures, the type that you're using, Gene, for example, in your videos, makes the process, the chart more appealing. I'm saying, as I said, something obvious, but it's something we should never forget. Hmm? If we insert some of these, circles with the images in them, it makes it pretty good. Okay. I've discovered that it works.
It does. I mean, I have, let's see, can I get there? I don't think I can get there from here. Oh, yeah, I can. I have a friend in Ireland.
Yeah,
Scotland.
That's what I meant. I'm talking about the images that suggested to
Jimbo created almost 800 of these little circular JPEG files for me to include in my system maps, and they all have the same sort of motif about them, and I can. If you look at this link for the Kumu template that I developed, there's a link down here where you can download all 800 of those images if you want them.
Yeah.
In a zip file.
Yeah.
And this is one of them imported into here. They're all 200 by 200 JPEG circles.
Yeah, and I think that they help. They help maintain the level.
Okay. Well, if there are no other comments, if there are other comments, please offer them. Otherwise, we should let people get about other things, and I'll go put this together and send it out in a while.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Have a nice whatever part of the day it is. In my case, I will have a nice dinner.
Okay.
Okay.
Goodbye, all.
Goodbye, all. Bye.
Bye.